Hi everyone, good afternoon. We are here to talk about accountability of the government, but what is accountability? We all know, there's no need to go into too much detail. We all know the importance of accountability in our day-to-day functions, our employment, or in our profession. Now, it is the basic responsibility to the person who had assigned us in our job or sought our expertise. They expect us to discharge those in an efficient and a competent manner. Now, how different that expectation could differ when we talk about what we expect from our government, which had been elected and placed in their positions of power. Now, what is the power that has been assigned to them is to take care of the resources of the state. They have to account to us how they make decisions, make policies, and pass laws. Okay. It includes where they are compelled, where they should also be compelled to provide explanations when matters within the administration goes wrong. What we have usually is some untenable explanation like, we do not have a blame culture, just to absolve themselves. Is this acceptable? Now, excuse me. Besides these matters, there are so many. I was told I've got only 10 minutes. If I were to go into going all the areas where accountability has fallen short, I think I'll do not know how long the speech will last. In fact, I have to perhaps write a volume of 10 books. But now, I will try to restrict my areas of concern to economic matters. Now, there are other matters too, like education, healthcare, housing, just to cite a few. Now, what did we have when things go wrong? A wall of silence in many instances, in fact, most instances. Okay, now, why accountability is a serious issue? Since time immemorial, when one looks through the history of mankind, what was the essential motivation for the formation of a government? It was essentially to control the resources of the state. Now, control the resources of the state for whose interest? Okay, that is debatable for various governments at various times. But for the present-day democratic government, that is not a very far-off description. They are there to control how the state resources are employed for the benefit of the people. Okay, they are supposed to employ the resources in the interest of the people. They are expected to exercise control over the material resources of the state appropriately in order that they are available to the entire population, not just a select group of elite. After all, it's not that just the elites that had voted them into power. In the past, however, various kingdoms were often dominated by select exclusive groups like the royal family, who will enact laws which essentially creates a formula of resource distribution through which they amass their own wealth in a very disproportionate manner. Now, throughout history, much tumultuous events have taken place to correct the situation, and now we have a supposedly democratic environment where our resources are managed by a government elected by the people. Besides the difficulty with the government, there were also many instances where the economic environment of a country does not function, and it does not function in such a way that it provides for the well-being of the citizens, and at times even it can turn into an ecosystem of a ruthless, the powerful preying on those economically weak. Under such conditions, the ordinary citizens look upon the government as the social leveler. Okay, so the government is to turn up and say, look, we will manage the situation, you will get what is required to go on with your lives. Against this backdrop, how then do the present-day parliamentarians are expected to carry out this duty and differ from the past? The key point is democratic principles. Their political power conferred upon them is essentially to carry out these democratic objectives of providing people from the state resources. In that regard, how had our government measured up to the requirements of accountability and transparency? Let us look briefly from the economic perspective. Like I said, there are many areas, but let's focus on the economic policies that they have taken very briefly. After the PAP came to power in 1959, one of the first things they did, they went about passing laws to acquire land on the principle of socialism. Of course, many things happened between 1959 and 1960. We shall not go into all those and restrict ourselves to their economic functions. The economy had been gradually shaped through industrialization and construction industry by the government, who had actually already become the largest landowner in the 1960s. The capital for economic investment too were funded by the taxes and of course the CPF. To the extent that in the 1980s, something like 25% from the citizen and another 25% from the employer was contributed monthly for the retirement needs of the individual. But what happened? Despite having 50% of a person's salary at that time, a person who probably was in his 25 to 30 years, who would now be about 65 to 70, does not get to see his CPF unless he follows the rule and says, I want my CPF at 65. What happened? No accountability here again. The government of the day exists for the purpose of providing people with the public goods for the well-being of the people. What are deemed as public goods? One of the main public goods is the shaping of the economy, where individual citizens could go there, contribute their labor, and secure a livelihood for themselves to maintain a decent livelihood. An economic environment should exist which is conducive for that purpose, from which the citizen could derive their subsistence. What did we have instead for most of the last 20 years? We have the economy being shaped to accommodate more foreigners with the locals sidelined. Various reasons were given, but how many of you are satisfied with those reasons given, I wonder. For the purpose of providing an environment of conducive labor, there are many government-controlled unions too, since the 1960s. Were the unions taking their necessary steps to ensure the local workers get their fair economic pie? I don't think so. Were the unions accountable to the people for the role they had purportedly taken up to provide a conducive working environment, a fair working environment? I doubt so. What happened in the 1990s before the turn of the century? could be best regarded as actions which went counter to the responsibilities. The government had then had unilaterally decided that for the economic expansion of the country, they had decided to rely on foreign labor, leaving the local labor, who were considered to have costed them too highly, who were gradually replaced. This had largely left them in a lurch. Many of them had was stagnated in their job, or even had fallen back. And when you talk about the cost being of labor being high, the local labor cost being high, what is the main reason for the local labor cost being high? It is also due to the fact that the main driver of cost of living is the government themselves, with all their fees, mainly the cost of HDB and all their taxation structures. It demonstrated the over-accommodation of foreigners in the local economy demonstrated that a government, instead of operating the economy for the people using the resources, had diverted the operation to that of Singapore Inc., an entity of a corporate nature. This was clearly due to the lack of accountability requirements having become too lax. It further seems that big businesses, after all, you know, when the government involves in business, it's big business. Big businesses, being what they are, would always want to become bigger. Bigger in terms of profit, revenue, and assets under their control. And our government had largely shaped these functions as such and had acquired the clout of a business entity, largely ignoring the needs of the individual. Clearly, the consequences of the much that accountability was lacking. We all know the importance of accountability, and this wasn't there when it was much needed. How is it that the foreign labor could be replaced, foreign labor could very much occupy the positions of the locals? With the economy shaped by the people's collective resources, it clearly belonged to the people. The signing of trade pacts, for example, the signing of trade pacts in the 1990s, however, with little or no consultation from the average citizen, largely ignored the consequences on those at the bottom socio-economic ranks, who are largely, is this called being accountable? When objected to, when it was asked, how is it that the foreigners are replacing the locals to this extent? The reply we got was, foreigners create good jobs for the locals. That is it. How and in what manner? No explanation of any sort was provided, and that is being accountable to the people. Is this how the economy of the country is supposed to be of benefit to the people? Where was the transparency and how the people's interest would be served by such trade pacts like SICA? No details have been provided thus far. So much for being accountable to the people. Luckily, we did not have the TPP, the Trans-Pacific Partnership, going through. Then it will be another chapter on accountability on the economics by the government. Next, the tax scheme. The taxation of the country should be operated in a fair manner, such that there is fairness in how it is collected and there is fairness in how it is channeled for the benefits of the citizens. Do we have that? In the context of a democratic government elected and installed by the people, for the people, the essential motivation of the government should be to lessen the financial burdens upon the people. Are we having that in any way? Could we even expect to have those without the transparency and accountability? Now, ongoing? No way. So, in total, what are the consequences when accountability is lacking in the functions of the government, and why is it essential? The reality is with the absence of accountability, a government takes a closer step toward a draconian monarchy of the past. The essential hallmark of a democratic government is the clear demonstration of being accountable to the people who had placed them in the position of power. What could result if the lack of accountability is further left unaddressed? It is an accepted fact and acknowledged that we do not function as a political system within the conventional meaning of democracy, preferring to call ourselves a unique democracy. The uniqueness seems to be the blurred lines in the separation of powers, which normally would underpin the healthy functioning of democracy. The lack of clarity in the absence of accountability will only worsen. One example to consider with regard to our parliamentarians: where does the partisan interest end and where does the interest as the people's representative begin? They do not seem to be subjected to any constraints of accountability or transparency. A simple question that needs to be urgently asked, understood and plainly answered by all Singaporeans now: are all these good for the country? How could the situation be improved to iron out the conflicts of interest? Inevitably, the reply would be ensuring of the accountability of the ruling party towards the people who had elected them. Their abhorrence for the check and balance mechanism is well known, preferring to follow the own self, check own self system, and that has been the order of the day all along. That should not continue. I thank you.